FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome, and you are listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz. Today is September 4th, 2018. That means it's time for Mickey Fulp's monthly major market review for August 2018. Mickey, welcome back. Another month has come and gone.
This is true, Kerry, and it's past Labor Day, so everybody's back to work today, and that's good news.
Yeah, well, not everybody. There's a lot of people in Florida here that just don't work, period. But
hey. Well, trust me, there's a lot of those in New Mexico that are on the government dole.
I want to say that.
But people that actually work for a living, we're all back at work today. How about that?
Yeah. Those of us who actually are somewhat gainfully employed, yes, we're back. And wow, what can you say about last month? The stock markets just keep on chugging along like old man river.
It's pretty amazing what's going on with U.S. markets. And Kerry, it really is restricted to U.S. markets for the most part. We had record highs again, and they occurred on Friday, pretty much across the board, with the exception of the Dow. But the Dow was up over 2% on the month, closed at 25,965. I want to go through the yearlies too. Year to date, up 5%. S&P 500 all-time record high on Friday at 2902, up 3% for the month, 8.5% on the year. NASDAQ 8110, up almost 6% on the month, 17.5% on the year. And the small business, small cap stocks, the Russell 2000, which is really the driver of the U.S. economy, closed at 1741, all-time high, up over 4% on the month and over 12% for the year. My gosh, Kerry, the U.S. markets are on a roll. The U.S. economy is on a roll.
Hey, we had 4.1 and then it was upgraded to revised upward to 4.2%. We hadn't seen that since 2014, and that was a fake one quarter exception. It's probably going to be higher next quarter as well.
Well, I don't know, and you're talking about GDP, which I think you failed to mention, but yeah. I don't know if it'll be higher, but we'll see what it comes in. But we haven't seen this sort of growth, annualized growth. I can't remember when, maybe 2005, something like that.
Before the crash, pre-crash.
Yeah. But like I say, it's really becoming restricted to U.S. markets. And, you know, the world is in a titter about trade tariffs and Trump, and Trump's tweaking Trudeau, and the Canadian markets are behaving badly. The Toronto Venture Exchange was down well over 1% on the month, essentially is flat for the year. The nanocap sector, which we follow quite closely, actually made a little bit of a rally the last few days in anticipation of better days ahead after Labor Day. Closed at 725, up 2.5% on the month, but down a whopping 15% on the year. Right. Emerging market countries significantly underperforming, down once again 3% on the month to 1054, down a whopping 9% on the year. This goes all the way from China to Turkey, yes, to Greece to Italy. The Eurozone is in a world of hurt. It does not appear that you should cross Trump too harshly, as Erdogan has done in Turkey. The lira has dropped a massive 40%. And he made some statement, I can't quite remember what it was on Friday, but that the U.S. is a bully, and he's going to use all he's going to use alternative currencies, presumably the lira on
Bitcoin,
and not do any trading in U.S. dollars. Yeah. We'll see how that
good luck there.
Ends up.
Hey, well, yeah. Just as an aside, people who cross Trump, bad things happen to them. It's not like other presidents where they wound up in single car accidents or small plane crashes or committed suicide with two to the head. But just bad things happen to them, to their standing in the world, in the community, in their profession. They seem to fall from grace. That red hen place, that whole town in Virginia that kicked out some Trump officials.
Oh, yeah, right.
They're like, it's hard times. It's like they're in Appalachia trying to pick coal out of spent seams, like nobody's going there. So just as an aside, don't cross the man because bad things are going to happen to you. Well, looking at our money scene.
Well, let me say, I don't think it's the man as much as it is. It's, the U.S. economy. We're still $20 trillion GDP per year. If you take all these countries that Trump has threatened with trade tariffs or has gotten on the bad side, their entire GDP collectively is $15 trillion. So we remain the 800-pound gorilla on the economic block here. And I think Americans should be proud of that.
Yeah, well, it certainly makes a difference in a lot of ways when it's important. So you really need to keep things in perspective here. I said from the get-go, Mickey, that these trade wars were not anything. They were meaningless, not meaningless because the U.S. is entitled to better terms on these deals, but yeah. Meaningless in the scheme of the world financial system. Nothing is going to happen. Yeah, Canada, bad things are happening because politically they find it untenable to deal with Trump. But China, I know that I am so certain of it that things will be worked out because they have no choice.
Well, I think things are going to be worked out with Canada, too. I mean, this is really with Canada come down to supply management of Quebec dairy farms. And
yeah.
And Trudeau can't back down easily because he's a Quebecois and a significant amount of his support is from Quebec. So but it's a proverbial drop in the milk bucket, if you will. So eventually, I think it's all going to work out. Your point on China, I think, is well taken, too. $200 billion of imported goods threatened with trade tariffs. Well, do the math. If we put 10% tariffs on $200 billion in China, that's $20 billion, and that's less than one-tenth of 1% of the U.S. GDP.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And, you know, the Chinese, they've never dealt with anybody like Donald Trump before, you know, they never have. And
I don't think anybody
has. That's for sure. So let's get to our money here.
Sorry.
We do have a
sorry
schedule
for the digression.
That's okay. It's always fun.
Bit of a rant today.
So. Hey, it's okay. So we're looking at money. So dollar up again. Dollar is getting back up to where it was a few months back.
Well, the dollar actually closed up about a 0.5% to 95.1, rounded off. But it was really, really strong mid-month. It went as high as 96.7 and became very overbought before it came back to reality. It significantly affected precious metals, and we'll talk about that in a bit. But the euro continues to show weakness. We've already talked about the problems in Turkey and Greece and Italy. The pigs plus Turkey. I don't know if that's the turds or what, but the euro was off to $1.16. 10-year treasury keeps bumping up against resistance at 3%, closed it last at 2.86. And finally, Bitcoin which is not money. We need to find a separate category for it, but we don't know where to put it. In speculative financial instruments, it closed the month at 71.04, and it only lost 6%, so it wasn't that volatile. But note, in mid-month, it hit a low of 6,100 before it recovered. But geez, from a high of 19,300 and down to 7,100, that's quite a drop, Kerry.
Hey, and I called it within a day. I called the peak in Bitcoin. And don't ask me how I did it, because then I would have to try to repeat it with another market. And I'm not that good a chart reader. But there's no surprises there. What goes up will eventually come down. And that was the story in the metal sector last month. My God, it's unbelievable.
Yeah. The price of gold hit something on the order of a 2.5-year low during the month. Went as low as 1173 on a London close. Closed at 1200. Really is controlled in very strong negative correlation U.S. dollar. It came back, lost 2% on the month. Silver was a big loser, 6.5% loss at 1448. The gold-silver ratio is at 83, a level we have not seen, since the global economic crisis. Platinum had a horrible month, down to 785. That's a 10-year low. The gold to platinum, the platinum to gold ratio is now at 0.65, another all-time low. The one metal that bucked the trend was palladium. We don't really look at it as a precious metal, although it trades in price. It's really an industrial metal.
Correct.
It closed up 5% at 975. But I want to mention, too, the platinum to palladium ratio is 0.81. That is a low since 2001.
At this rate, they're going to have to stop mining platinum. There can't be any profit in you know, how much can you make at $7.85 an ounce? I mean,
well, yeah. So these South African platinum producers and realize that something on the order of 75% of the world's platinum does come from South Africa. They've been losing money for a long time, but the real problem is there's stockpiles, supply stockpiles in South Africa. So the market continues to be oversupplied with platinum. There is already movements to convert platinum, palladium catalytic converters to more and more platinum.
Yeah,
so at some point this will turn around. We just don't know when it's going to be.
Hey, you know, the market always corrects. You know, it might not go on our schedule, but it always corrects. I mean, God, look at the carnage in the copper market there. It's just past 3 months, it's just been devastating.
Yeah, there's a bunch of things going on in the copper market. There has been no supply disruption this year, and all the analysts and speculators and traders bake in a 4% supply disruption for strikes, for weather, for accidents, for geopolitical risk, for whatever reason, and that has not happened this year. That's one of the things going on. Despite record imports from China of cons and ores, the copper market is being massively shorted on both sides of the Pacific. Massive hedge funds that have really disrupted the market. Most of the month, copper was in backwardation, anywhere from 7 to 9 months in backwardation. That's unheard of. Copper closed the month at 272, down 3.4%. And as I look on the board on the 4th of September here, Kerry, copper is down to 264 right now, which will be approaching a 2.5-year low. And that is solely because the U.S. dollar has risen once again. It's at 95.4 this morning.
My goodness. All right. And then finally, last but not least, our energy sector, at least something went up.
Yeah. Mid-month, oils were very much oversold. WTI went as low as 64.50, completely oversold with supply-demand balance. We've got a lot of oil coming off market, especially with Iran sanctions and Venezuela failing. The market closed at its month high at 69.93 for almost a 2% gain on WTI. Brent closed at 77.40, up 4%. But get this, the Brent to WTI ratio is up there once again at an 11% arbitrage. So that's a high that's we've seen late, in the last few months. But it picked up about 5% this month. Henry Hub, natural gas continues to muck around. We're approaching the end of the summer cooling season. It closed at 292, up 14 cents. That's just normal noise in the market. The energy sector that continues to perform quite well is uranium, up steadily the entire last 3 months. Hit a two-year high at 26.43. Still got a long way to go, Kerry. We need $40 uranium.
It's got to go up 35% from here to 45% to really be where it needs to be, so that the miners can make money at it and we'll have adequate supply. But one of those things it will correct eventually. I mean, this reminds me of the sugar market of the late 80s, early 90s, where sugar went down to a penny a pound. And everybody had given up on sugar. There was just too much of it, and sugar prices would never go up. And then later on, it went up 10, 12, 14, 18 cents a pound. You don't know when it's going to happen, but you know from the dynamics that it has to happen. I mean, that's just the way markets work.
It is the way markets work, and there's a history of uranium. When it starts going up, it goes up very quickly. So as a contrarian, rest assured, folks, that I've got some uranium stocks that I'm sitting on that are performing better, but they will perform very well when the price of uranium goes up. Finally, one ratio we didn't talk about, which I want to, is gold to WTI. Closed the month at 17.2. We have not seen that sort of ratio since the beginning of the oil crash back in October, the end of October in 2014. For those interested, I just posted two musings over the last 2 weeks. The second one came out to the public today called The History of Gold and Oil Ratios. Basically tells you how many barrels of oil you can buy with an ounce of gold. So we are getting at 17.2. That is within the most common range, something like almost one-third of the time. So we're getting back to normal. And your point that markets always move to normalcy when they are overbought or oversold is really illustrated by the price, the gold oil ratio right now.
Hey, and let's not forget when oil was crashing, it was down to below $30 a barrel. It's up to close to 70 today.
Yes, it's over 70 today. Yeah. as I'm looking right now. Yeah, 70 opened this morning at almost $71.
Yeah, perfect example. And we could go on and on with the examples. So whatever is happening now, eventually the market will assert itself. The fundamentals will prevail. We just don't know when, but it's going to happen. And there's a lot happening with Mickey's site, mercenarygeologist.com. Make sure you check out his Twitter feed at mercenarygeo. Our Twitter feed is at Carrie Lutz and the website Financial Survival Network. Hey, by the way, you know, you're listening, you enjoy the show, pass it on to somebody else, send them a link. Love to get more people hearing this information, because there's very few people out there who actually go back and look at the past, review performance, and draw parallels into potential future scenarios. And you can email us too if you got any questions. We love getting your emails, kl@carrielutz.com. Mickey, we will see you next month, same bat time and same bat channel.
And the past is prologue. We should always remember that, Carrie. Thanks a lot. My pleasure. Talk to you next month.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.